Learn how to call a REST endpoint from Azure SQL Database super easily, including some new announcements this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, we're going to be talking about an exciting new topic with Davide from the SQL Database team. Davide, thanks so much for joining us today.
Hey, Anna. Good morning. Good evening. Good afternoon. Thanks a lot for having me again.
Yeah, it's always great to have you on the show. You're always showing us the latest and greatest cool things for developers, and today is no exception. Yeah. We're going to be talking about calling a REST service from Azure SQL Database. And before we get into it, can you tell us, like, why would you want to do that?
It's a $100 million question. No, it's a great question and very common, so I'm glad that you asked me. Well, the point is that today, integrating with other services, especially in Azure, is super important, right? So the ability to take the data that you already have and send it to an Azure function or call an Azure cognitive services for further processing to apply maybe some machine learning techniques or send it to Power BI by pushing it instead of pulling it, just make everything easier. Now, is this something you should do every time, every day of the year? Of course not. But it's a tool that you have in your tool set so that when you need to, for example, push some data, let's say to update a simple internal website that shows how many orders are coming in or how many open tickets there are, you can just use Azure SQL and you don't have to overcomplicate your architecture by adding more stuff to it, like specialized service to move data around or writing a lot of code to basically obtain what you now can do with just one line of code. So the point for me, the point is giving developers the opportunity to choose what is the best architecture for them. That's mainly my pitch for this feature, which I really, really love.
Okay, got it. I feel like this is a pretty good pitch because a lot of folks have seen interest and have started using this already, even though it's just in public preview. My next question would be, like, as someone who might be just getting started, like, what are some of the things that you can do with this or how do you get started?
Yeah, so I prepared this picture that hopefully is clear enough to explain that from Azure SQL now, you can pretty much reach any service that we have in Azure and that somehow needs to deal with data. Actually, we already are running SP invoke external REST endpoint. This is the name of the feature. It's a little bit long, but we had to stay within the naming convention we already have. So with SP invoke external REST endpoint, you can call or you can send a request to any REST service that we expose in Azure and even outside Azure. I will get to that in just a minute. So, for example, you can send your data to a function to be processed and then get the result. Again, just one line of code. Or you can send a message to Event Hub for further processing with other services. Or you can query data, save it or store it in Power BI. So, for example, let's say you have a DAX query and you need the result into your database for any reason. Well, you don't have to do anything special other than just call a stored procedure and call the REST Power BI endpoint. So everything is super simple. And I have some demo, if you want, that should simplify the explanation and give you a sense of what you can do.
Yeah, definitely. Let's take a look.
Yeah. So let me go immediately here where I have. I'm starting with the most common use case that we are seeing customers using. So you have an Azure function that does something. It could manipulate data, could crunch the data, or it just can take some payload and do something with that. Who knows? But the point is that you need some data in your database to be sent to that function to do whatever you need to do. Today is super easy to do that with SP invoke external REST endpoint. You basically just specify the URL that you want to call. In this case, it is a test function that I have that returns information about some person and some order. You can send any payload as long as it's JSON. But I have a news that I want to share with the people watching this data exposed episode. I'll give you the announcement at the end of the session, so stay tuned. But basically, for now, let's say you just send JSON a payload. You can specify custom headers, so pretty regular what you would normally do in a Node or .NET to call a HTTP endpoint. And then you execute the story procedure. And the result will be returned to you in this response output. So let me just show to you how it works. It's pretty easy. So you just execute the story procedure. The function take a few seconds or a few milliseconds. It really depends what it's doing. And then you have the result. The result is split in two sections. The response, where you have all the metadata about the result that you received, so basically the HTTP status and the headers that has been sent back to you from the service you have called. And the result is actually the payload that has been sent back to you from the function. So it's the result of the function, if you want. And in this case, as you can see, we have JSON that contains information about something that needs to be shipped by to this person related to an order that she made. Super easy. And now if you think also that we are just announced some new nice support to JSON payloads or to JSON data in SQL Server 2022, it's even easier to manipulate this result because it's JSON. Now you have a native function in Azure SQL to manipulate JSON, so it fits very well together. It's super easy for a developer to manipulate or even generate a payload. Function is definitely the most common service to create a serverless REST endpoint. But let's say you have an Azure static web app that also contains function. You can even call a static web app if you want, and it just works the same way. Or instead, if many companies are using containers and, for example, Kubernetes to host their APIs, you can even call that with zero problem. So, for example, here I'm executing a function that queries my album data on a container. The container probably was sleeping, so it needs to wake up. And now here you go. Here's my container. So as you can see, it's super simple. Like literally, it's one line of code, yeah. Right? So it just makes everything easier. And integration now, it's what I like to say, one line of code away, because with that, you can do pretty much everything.
Thanks, Davide. This is super cool. You know, one question I have is that in your demo, you were showing us a lot of ways that you can read data. Is this primarily for reading applications and the data in them?
Well, that's probably the most common thing because you just want to consume data coming from a service, but you can actually push data. So, for example, here, I think I have an example somewhere. Let me open a function. Let's say you want to send some data to a function, right? So you want to push data out. And let's say that the function doesn't return anything because it doesn't really process the data. It just act on the data it has received. Like, for example, send an email, send a warning, whatever, right? So as long as you ship JSON data, you can put your payload as something that is also sent when the function is called. So it's, I would say, in and out, definitely.
Nice. Awesome. Okay, yeah. Cool. My next question is, you have a lot of exciting things on the left-hand side of your screen, Event Hubs, Power BI, queues. Like, what's going on here?
Well, it's just what I was saying before. You can integrate with pretty much everything. So a very common pattern today is event-driven application or architectures, where actually you have a hub like Kafka Hub or Event Hub in Azure that basically listen to messages that are coming in and acts on those messages, right? So let's say that you want to build something that is reactive or event-based also with Azure SQL. Well, today it's super easy. You just have to set up an event hub. And I have an application here that I can start. And this application just listen to messages coming into my event hub. And now let's say that I receive an order or whatever, and I want to make sure that my message is sent about that order is also sent to my event hub as a kind of an integration pattern. As you can see here, I can just do SPVOC external REST endpoint. I point to my event hub. In this case, I'm even specifying the partition, and I specify my payload. So the payload will be the user ID and some other data. And I am on the wrong database. So let me go here. Here we go. And it will just work nice. So let me go here again. Let's do it. And Here we go. So the status is created. So I would expect here to have a message received. That's pretty nice. And also pretty fast. And now imagine that now everything is happening on my machine and being sent to Azure and back. But something happened here. Yeah, that's my sample application that where I don't really manage everything correctly, but who cares? Because the only thing I want to show is that I am sending messages, and you see it's super fast. It's almost immediate. We optimize the code
nice
as much as possible to make everything super fast, and also it's super secure because, as you're probably noticing here, I'm also specifying some credential. That's because we don't want to have, for example, the shared access signature or other sensitive data available in clear text in the script that you may want to share. So we also support credentials, so you can safely store the credential needed to call any server safely in Azure SQL. And therefore, you can call anything securely. You can manage who can access which URL or HTTP endpoint, because we added permission to manage everything from a security standpoint. And so, for example, let's say I want to call Power BI, I want you to be able to call my Power BI, but I don't want to give you my credential. I can just safely store my credential somewhere. And the only thing is that I have to give you the permission to use my credential. And so I created this credential to specifically allow you to only call a specific data set, so you can go as specific as you want. And then let me just execute this. We will get the result. This is a DAX query executed in Azure SQL right now. And how can you trust me about that, since you see just a table here? Well, let me show you the JSON that we received. This is the JSON that is coming from Power BI. And as you can see, is formatted in its own specific way, but since it's JSON, it's very easy for me to turn it into a table. So now I can, for example, join this data with other table that I have, and everything is just easier for what concerns integration. So that's pretty interesting, in my opinion.
Wow, that's awesome, Davide. Okay, one of my last questions as we start to wrap up is, you've shown us some great samples. Is there somewhere folks can go today to try this out?
Yeah, absolutely. So here, if you go to the SP Invoke External REST Endpoint documentation page, you have all the details about also how to use managed identity, which is something that especially enterprises asked us to implement. So you have a list of all the endpoints you can call. Now, why we limit the endpoints to all those that are within the Azure domain? Because we need to make sure that you are calling really the service that you think you are calling. So we want to avoid the DNS poisoning attacks or other nastier attacks. So we need to make sure that we own the DNS. But if you need to call a completely external service, let's say a service hosted in your friend's house, well, just use API management and SP Invoke External REST Endpoint plus API management, a service that you can use in Azure, allows you to reach any service anywhere in the world. And the last thing I want to mention is that here at the end, if you go just down the documentation page, you have a link to a GitHub repository that is full of examples on, for example, how to use API management, cognitive services, event hub, and basically pretty much I shown today. I just have one last new I want to share with you, something really new. Of all the services we are supporting here, probably you have noticed that some big services is missing, Azure Storage. Now, as we speak, Azure Storage is being added to the supported service, so you will be able from SP Invoke External REST Endpoint to query an Azure blob or an Azure file or an Azure queue, Azure Storage queue, and interact with those entities. For example, create a file, read a file, send a message to a queue, read message from a queue, so that the support for the Azure services, the most common Azure services, is complete. So you can have really full integration from Azure SQL with everything in just one line of code, which make developers super efficient.
Awesome. That is super exciting. You heard it here first on Data Exposed.
Yes.
Davide, thanks so much for coming on the show. I learned a lot. I think our viewers probably learned a lot as well. To our viewers, check the description. We'll put some links for you to learn more, especially the things that Davide referenced. Leave us a comment and let us know what you're doing with this new capability. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.